that you are constant, that you are a rock of ages, that you are a strong tower, and when the tempest come, we can proclaim that it is well. Lord, I pray for our own souls. There is one here that is unwell. May they feel your Spirit's leading today. May you comfort those that need comfort. May you challenge those that need challenging. And Lord, our prayer is that you would be glorified as the Savior of our souls. And Lord, we love you. We thank you that we could boldly go before your throne because of the finished work of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. I did want to just share with you a few things, reminders. Tonight, March is coming in like a lion, and so we're supposed to get a significant amount of snow, so there are no evening service activities here tonight, and so I just wanted to make sure that you knew that, didn't fight your way in through the snow and then be like, where is everybody? We won't be here, and so neither should you be. But we do want you here for our missions conference, and so we have a men's breakfast in the morning. We also have a ladies' luncheon, and we have the evening kickoff on Saturday that starts off with a meal. And so we're going to eat a lot. That's what good Baptists do. And so we're going to kick off our missions ministry doing that. But we want to make sure that we have enough. And so please sign up, go out, and we have some right there at the Welcome Center online. We will have things sent out to you as well as last week's MailChimp and things like that. But we want to make sure that we get an accounting of who's going to be there so we can prepare accordingly. And of course, you're going to be there, so we look forward to seeing you next Saturday and Sunday. We're in Ecclesiastes chapter 7. In 1888, there was a young chemist named Alfred. And Alfred's brother, Ludwig, passed away. And he wasn't able to be close to him during his time of passing, so he ran to get a newspaper and he opened it up to read the obituary. And it's not a day like today where you could easily stay in contact and know exactly how you were regarded or where you were currently. And so he got the newspaper and he opened it up. And to his surprise, they confused which brother passed away. And he was reading his own obituary. And the title of it was this: The Merchant of Death is Dead. Pretty harsh. And it began to talk about how he happened to be the inventor of dynamite and how dynamite was used in that day and age. I mean, it was the atomic bomb that they had, right? It was the most destructive thing that they had, to see people perish, to take over countries or whatever in war. And so they were looking at his legacy, and he's basically saying, you know what, you created something that causes great death, something that is not used for peace, but instead used for turmoil. And he began to see how the world saw his invention. And he became committed to changing that narrative. He didn't want his true obituary to be what this obituary was saying about him. He didn't want to forever be known as being the man that brought death and destruction to the world. And so he started to use his fortune, and he had a significant fortune, for purposes of peace, and to recognize and celebrate those that were bringing about peace in the world. His name is Alfred Bernard Nobel. And you may know the Nobel Peace Prize is given out to those that do a fantastic job in bringing peace to the world, and it's one of the most prestigious, honored things that one could ever receive. What a wonderful opportunity to be able to almost, you know, read an obituary or go to your funeral and see the areas in which, boy, if I had to do over again, I would change that narrative, right? I would live a better life. I would do better things. Solomon is kind of having one of those moments. In chapter 7, he is talking about how we could live a better life in wisdom, and he is putting it against a very strong tutor, and the tutor is death. And so he's having a stare into the face of death, which can be a pretty intimidating stare, and saying, how is your legacy? Are you prepared, or is your life warranting a life well lived so that when you pass on from this earth, you have a good legacy, a good name, a good testimony? And he's asking these very deep, philosophical, challenging, spiritual questions. And he continues throughout this passage to use the word better. He's saying there is a better way. There's a foolish way. There's an easy way. There's the normal way. And then there's the better way. There's a wisdom way. And so if you would just circle the word better through chapter 7, it would probably come up around 7 times that you would be circling that word better. There's a better way to live your life. And he gives us kind of a blueprint to how to have a better legacy when we leave this earth. You know, he's saying that if we even consider some dark and heavy things like death, it can be a good challenge, a good tutor. If you think of Ebenezer Scrooge, right? It certainly changed his obituary, his ending around. And I'm hoping that through the power of the Holy Spirit, that as we look through this passage, chapter 7, perhaps we would see areas that through God's strength and by his grace could be better, could be changed, could be enriched. We could be transformed. He starts off in verse 1 and he says, a good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth. So he says, a good name is better than precious ointment. Now, you have to understand something. If they had precious ointment in the days of Solomon, you were very well to do. As a matter of fact, it was very prestigious to have beautiful ointment, to have an amazing aroma perfume. If you even think of Mary, when she broke it and poured it over Jesus' feet and washed his feet with her hair, that perfume was her dowry. I mean, it was her future. It was so expensive and so rare and so beautiful. And what he's saying is that it's better to have a good name than to have luxury. It's better to have a good name than a beautiful smelling perfume. It's better to have a good name than a snappy suit. It's better to have a good name than a bank account that's full. You know, depending on what part of the world you were born and what culture you understand, this means more to some cultures than others. If you come from an Eastern culture, there's an honor-shame culture, right? And you understand maybe even more powerfully what it means to have a good name than a Western culture. I mean, a good name is everything. How are you remembered? Remember your name. Your last name has meaning and power. Now, I think all of us have had our parents at one time or another remind us, hey, be good tonight. You're a Sanders, right? You have a good name. Don't besmirch it. How much more, as a child of God, do we need to be aware of our name? Do we need to be aware of how we live our lives? He's saying that we should be careful that we don't just chase after the luxuries, and if we have all the things that this world has to offer, but we're known as a crummy person, what good is it? If we smell beautiful through expensive perfume, but our reputation stinks, who really cares? A good name is better than luxury. Honor is better than these things. And that one, I think all of us would kind of get. Yes, a name is more important than stuff. But the next one is a little bit more challenging. He says, in essence, your death day is better than your birthday. That one kind of makes us say, what? I mean, I don't know about you, but the day of my daughter's birth was a day of great joy, like unbelievably amazing moments. There were a few on the way to that I'd like to forget, but in the moment of seeing our babies, unbelievable. And what it is there's all this promise, right? Here is a bouncing little baby girl, and her life is all to be written. And you feel the joy of God giving you that privilege, that gift. And it is an amazing gift. But all they are is potential. They don't have a story yet. They have no legacy to leave. They could be as significant as an Abraham Lincoln or an Einstein, or they could be as horrible as a Hitler or Stalin. You do not know. All they are is potential in a bassinet. Completely dependent on you for a while. A name is given at birth, but a reputation will be earned through one's life. And so he's saying that when you come to someone's death, and here oftentimes we would call it a celebration of what? Of one's life, right? You're able to look at how God used them. You're able to look at the road that they traveled, and you're able to say, wow, there is a legacy. They meant something in the brief moment that they were here. They made a difference by God's grace and for his glory. And so we realize that in one sense, birth just being about potential, that death is a referendum of who we are and what we were able to do and what we enjoyed. And so he's saying that in that way, it's better. But it's also better because death is the fulfillment of God's plan. That God has called that individual home. I believe in a sovereign God. I think that when we go home to be with the Lord, God doesn't say, what are you doing here? This was an accident. I didn't see this one coming. How did you get here? God is sovereign. And in his sovereign plan, he plans for us to do certain things and to live a certain period of time and in different circumstances, in different ways, ups and downs and challenges. And then he calls us home. It's a completion. And depending on the different stories of life, some I look at and say, well, praise the Lord, this person was ready to go home. They closed their eyes and they went and saw their Savior. And you're like, that seemed natural. That seemed good. And then there are other circumstances that you look at and go, oh, that's a tragedy. So young. So devastating. And we certainly have our hearts break towards those that are taken away in the world's eyes too early. But here's what I can tell you. No homegoing of God's child is a tragedy. Not for them. It may be difficult on those that are left behind, but for every individual that goes home to be with the Lord, they are in a far better day than their birthday. They are not born into the land of the dying. Folks, that's what this is. From the moment you are born, you know what you start doing? Dying. You see death around you. You see sorrow around you. You see brokenness around you. You navigate through very difficult things. When you get to heaven, you enter into the land of the living. All things live. There is no death. There is no dying. There is nothing broken. There is nothing sad. And so we will not be fooled into thinking that it is such a tragedy when someone passes from this world to the next. We must realize that that person is to be envied. As hard as that is for our human minds to understand. Now, don't get me wrong. God put in us an innate desire to live long on this earth. We want to be here. I will be the first to tell you, I want to walk my daughters down the aisle. I want to do that. I want to hand them off to their husbands. I want to have grandkids. Not right now. And I want to spoil them and give them back to their moms and dads and laugh. I can't wait. I want to be 90-something years old on the back porch with Cheryl, sipping a cup of coffee, doing our devotions, having a conversation. I want to stick around. But if God calls me home on the way home from church tonight, hear me clearly. Do not be sad for Brian Sanders. Do not be. It is not a tragedy in any way. I am finally home. I am finally at rest in the land of the living, and all dying has ceased for me. That's a powerful thing. It's also interesting that as you look at your life, you see the value of what God has blessed you with, what God has done for you. A lot of times I think we can get distracted as we begin to move through the years of our life, and you hear people writing down what they call a bucket list, right? Things I wish I would have done, and now time's going to run out. I don't know if I'll get to them. I know of one individual that he wrote a don't cry for me list that he wanted read at his funeral. And he wrote down all the different things that God blessed him with in his life. And he's basically saying, don't cry for me. I got to experience all these wonderful and great things. I got to experience God's saving grace. When I just think about it in my own life, just think about it in your life. Some of the amazing, beautiful things that God has allowed you to enjoy. Right? I get to enjoy the hug and kiss of a real soulmate every day. I get to have the most wonderful girls in the world call me dad. I was able to have parents that taught me God's word from the moment I was born and led me to Christ at a young age, who nurtured me and stuck by me ups and downs, and do to this day. And then more trivial things. I was able to see the Eagles win the Super Bowl. I have a friend, Russ Miller, and he is the best cook I know, and he made the most perfect filet ever, and I tasted it. I ate it, right? I've got to go from Alaska to Hawaii, not in one road trip, and see both. And so, look, I could go on and on and on. And really, if you sit and think about all the blessings that God's given you in your life, they may not be the same as mine, and your list will look different. And quite frankly, your list could be really, really challenging. But here's what I can tell you. You know what my list should say? Brian Sanders sinned and rebelled against God, and he deserves eternity in hell, period. Don't cry for me. I've received God's grace, God's blessing, God's love. And so, as hard as it is to understand, I think if we really take a step back as children of God and look at it, we can say, my death day is better than my birthday. If you are not a child of God, that is not something that you can say. By God's grace, you're here this morning. And you're hearing the fact that for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and that means we can't stand before a holy God in our sins and expect him to welcome us into his home, but he will reject us from his presence into a lake of fire. Unless we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We realize that he is God's son, that he came to this earth because he loved us, that he lived a life that we couldn't live, perfectly obeying every commandment that God has, dying on the cross for our sins to pay for the injustice of sin that we own, and rising again victorious. And when we confess our sins before him, when we invite him to be our Lord and Savior, he blots them out forever. And we're able to stand before a holy God. And our death day is better than our birthday. I hope you know that God in that way. Death can be scary. It wants your all. It wants to make you terrified of it. But that's when we have to remind ourselves of what 2 Timothy 1:10 says. It says that our Savior Jesus abolished the power of death. It no longer has the power over us. The Apostle Paul taunted death. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Why? Because Christ defeated death. Jesus said this, I am the resurrection and the life. And so although death can be a good tutor to us, it does not have to be something that causes us to be afraid or in awe. Verse 2, he continues down this line of thinking, better to go to a house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for this is the end of all mankind, and the living will lay it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by sadness of face, the heart is made glad. He says, so a funeral is probably better for us than to go to a celebration, to a birthday party, to a graduation party. And when I read that a little bit, I'm like, but that's ridiculous. Funerals are so challenging. There's grief there. It's hard. Why? Why, Solomon, would you say that it's better to go to a house of mourning, that it's better to go to something that's heavy and hard than to a time of celebration and mirth and fun? Why? Why is sorrow better than mirth? Why is it better than laughter? Here's why. Because going to a funeral does more for your soul than going to a place of mirth. And what I mean by that is we really can avoid the big questions of life when things are easy and when we're in celebration mode. We just laugh and quip back and forth. Have a good time, and you should. That is also good for your soul. But what is better for your soul at times is to really take an accounting of your life. To step back and to say, how is my relationship with God? How are my relationships with others? Do you know in a funeral, more than anything else, I have had estranged family members come together afterwards, come down and say, Pastor, would you pray for us? We haven't talked to each other for years, but there was something uniting about us grieving together for this one person that we both love and care about. Some separated families, a husband and wife were not together, and they would never talk to each other, and they said, we gotta bury this bitterness. Mom's died. We should let it go. It happened at a time that was challenging. When you start to think about your life, what am I living for? What am I chasing after? What really is important to me? Is it the important things? Or are there futile things? Are there silly things that are taking over all my time, all my attention, all my life? I've got to recalibrate. I've got to change how I'm doing life. A funeral will make you think like that. More than a birthday party. Unless it's your birthday party getting older and older. Where am I wasting time? Where am I drifting? What am I not appreciating? All these things are there for us. And we realize that life zooms by so quickly, doesn't it? That it's important that we have these moments in our life where we really start to reflect, where we really start to look at life. I often think that it's kind of like an airplane our whole life, right? You're born and it's takeoff. And then, you know, you're kind of growing up as you're going up, right? And then you hit cruising altitude, you know, you're middle-aged. And then you start the descent, and I'm starting to feel the descent. And then tray tables are up, seat backs in their upright position, you're coming in for a landing, you know? It's like very quick. And Solomon's saying, make sure that you take accounting of these moments, these days, number them, go after them. Verse 4, the heart of the wise is in the house of the mourning, but the heart of the fool is in the house of mirth. He's also saying that sometimes in our struggle, sometimes when things are difficult, sometimes when things are hard, we have a tendency to go to some other thing to take away that heaviness, that burden, that challenge. And Solomon's saying, listen, maybe we shouldn't just run to the thing that brings us mirth all the time, but sometimes we should allow the struggle to develop us. Sometimes we should allow, we all want to go to our escape place. So when I'm stressed or when things are hard, I have this escape place. Some of those are just frivolous things that we do. Other times it's actually sinful things that we do. But we go to these escape places. And he's saying, don't just run to an escape place when things are difficult, when you're sitting in a sobering moment. But instead, allow yourself to really open up with the Lord, to allow the Spirit to kind of check your life. Do the hard work of grief. Do the hard work of difficulty. And many times the worst of us begins to bubble up when we are in those moments. And so our tendency is to avoid those things. You know, the worst thing that a doctor can say is all we're going to do is try to manage your situation. Try to manage your pain. Try to manage the struggle. Because what that means is there no longer is something that can cure you. And I think too often, instead of allowing the cure that God has for us, we run to some other savior, we run to some other thing, and we allow that to distract us, to pull us away from the stress or the challenge or the difficulty. And Solomon's saying, it's okay to grind. It's okay to be in a difficult place or a difficult season because God is refining you through that. God is making you stronger and better through that. Have you ever heard of the butterfly parable? There was once a man, he was walking along, he looked over and he saw a butterfly in a cocoon. And the butterfly was struggling so hard and so difficult. It couldn't fly, it couldn't move forward. And so what he decided to do for this little butterfly was help it out. And he just ripped open the cocoon just a little bit so it wouldn't have to fight as hard. And what do you think took place? The butterfly flopped out of the cocoon. But you know what that butterfly will never do? It'll never fly. The struggle is part of the process for it to be what it's intended to be. Sometimes when all we do is avoid the difficult, run from the hard, do it and mask it as quickly as possible with whatever your avoidance ways are, you're minimizing the full impact that God has for your growth, development spiritually, and ability to be able to fly in the future in the way that He desires for you to do so. And so don't reject God's painful work. Don't head to the house of mirth. Don't go to that bar. Don't go to that site. Don't head to the mall with your credit card. Don't try to numb the pain through television all the time or some distraction. But instead, run to Jesus and allow Him to teach you. Because that's where the fullness of life is found, in Him, and allowing Him to develop you. Psalm 90 says, teach us to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. And we realize that God allows hard things to make us caterpillars turn into the butterfly that he has for us to be. God also uses hard words in verse 5. It is better for a man to hear the rebuke of the wise than to hear the song of fools. For as crackling thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of fools. This also is vanity. God uses hard words. It's better to hear a rebuke of the wise than the song of fools. Hard words are required for you to be the person that God wants you to be. Hard words make soft hearts. Soft words make hard hearts. And there's many times that we want to be careful. We want to come up to someone and we want to share with them, but I don't want. I'm just going to tell them what they want to hear. I'm not going to offend them in any way. I'm not going to talk to them about the way that they're living their life. And what I can tell you is, those soft words, those what you think are friendly words, are actually allowing them to harden their hearts. And the longer and deeper one's heart is hardened, the harder it is for them to hear the truth. And so the best friends in your life are those friends that can speak hard words to you so that you can maintain and keep a soft heart. Now, it does say in the scriptures that we're to speak them, that they should be wisely spoken. In other words, they shouldn't be condemning. They shouldn't be harmful. They shouldn't be unkind. They shouldn't be mean-spirited. They shouldn't cause, verse 9, anger to come up, right? But Proverbs 27:6 says this, that the faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. Are you open to correction? Do you allow yourself to be teachable and humble? Solomon's saying it was good for him to have people come up to him and say, listen, king, this is an issue. You've got a problem. You're struggling. You're drifting. You're not thinking correctly. He's saying we all need this if we are going to live wise. It's better. It's better to do this. He's saying, I'm glad I have friends in my life who aren't afraid to get in my face. Now, of course, they've warranted that right. It's not like the first time they've ever had a conversation with me. It's, let me tell you all that you do wrong. But they've demonstrated that they've loved you. Then they have the right to speak freely into your life. And I have had need for that in my life. There have been different seasons, different times where I needed that conversation from a friend. And praise God, there was one bold enough, brash enough to do that. There have been moments in my life where elder boards have helped bring that into my life as a pastor, a shepherd, and they're shepherds as well, and I see things from their perspective, and they're able to tell me things from the perspective that they have. Now, here's what I can tell you, that when someone comes to me and they speak truth into my life, it's never an easy thing. And so we kind of reject it a little bit. I have a few stages that I'll go through, right? The first is denial. I don't know about that. Not all that bad. The second one is, well, let's talk about you, right? Oh, I see you see that in my life, but let me flip this around and you know, I don't think you walk on water. We create other enemies and make them scapegoats. And then after a period of time, the Holy Spirit teaches us they're right. How can I be better? How can I change? Praise God for friends that are that bold. He then talks about a tinderbox and how what happens is that with sin and different things in our life, it catches fire so quickly. It's like it's like you're in a moment, boom, and really that's how our heart can change. Like we're doing pretty well, we're walking with the Lord, and in a moment, whew, something comes up in our relationships, something comes up in our marriage, something comes up in our temptations, and it just starts a fire. And he's saying that fire comes on very quickly, but also it's like crackling thorns. You know, have you ever just put kindling down and you light it up and it's like, and you're like, wow, and then it disappears? It's like just momentary, it has no value or no worth. And I think another individual, another commentator that I read, he kind of took it this way, and I think this fits as well. He's basically saying that wise people don't laugh when they're on fire. But they say, help me, I'm on fire. This happened so quickly, but I need help. Praise the Lord that Jesus came to help those that are on the fire of their foolish ways and bad decisions. And he's faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to change your life. But you know what we often do? He says here that the tinder comes up, right? And we get caught on fire. And then for the crackling thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fools. This is also vanity. He's saying they're on fire, but they're just kind of laughing it off. Well, it is what it is. I'm in sin, but whatever. It'll be fine. How many marriages would be saved if at the point of the drift beginning, they said, I'm on fire. We need help. Instead, you just kind of laugh it off. It'll get better. Things will just give it time, fan the flame. And all of a sudden, it's all burned up. And someone finally goes to a counselor when they're completely back-to-back adversarial, can hardly stand the sight of each other, and they say, fix us. And here's two lumps of burned coal. And if only at the beginning of the drift, one of them said, there's fire here. We've got to reroute. We've got to change. At the beginning of a sin, do you realize it's easier to, that's the easiest time when the temptation arises to walk away from a sin. When you accept it, Satan sets the hook, your own heart and flesh enjoy it, and then it's harder and harder and harder to walk away from the sin. If we would be so wise to live a better life that when things start to bubble up, we go, I'm on fire, I need help. What a difference it would mean for us, for our legacy, for the kingdom work that we could accomplish for the Lord. Verse 8, he says, better is the end of a thing than the beginning. And the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. So we're not to look for shortcuts, quick fixes. He's saying that the end is better than the beginning, that we should try to finish strong, that we don't just look back at a season of our life and say, well, there was a period of time. There was a period of time that I did this. There was a period of time that I did that. But that we continue to move forward, that we continue to develop, that we continue to grow. Listen, there is no place that I read in Scripture that we should have a past tense walk with the Lord and say that's sufficient. God wants a present tense walk with everyone in here. So don't look back and say, well, man, that time when I was in that season, that's when I was really close to God. Hello? Right now, fight for that. We don't have a time where we say, but now I'm retired from serving God. I was saved, did it for a while, now I'm coasting into heaven. No. Work till the day he calls you home at trying to know him more and be like Christ. And that work is the Spirit's work, and so we open our hearts up to him to develop us and to change us and to grow us. Patience is better than pride, he says, that we're to trust God. We're to have patience in what he is doing. We shouldn't be quick to anger. James 1:19, slow to anger, not vent quickly, but instead, all right, I'm not going to get upset. I'm going to let God continue to work. I'm going to let this situation grow me and develop me. In verse 10, he continues to unpack this, and he says, say not, why were the former days better than these? For it is not from wisdom that you ask this. He's saying that the present is better than the past. Rather than trusting God today, we all have a tendency to have a version of yesterday that is nostalgic. A version of yesterday that can tend to be better. We love to dress up the past. And it's a part of our escapism as human beings. And so we go back to that place in our mind and think, that's when everything was good. And that's when everything was great. But I could tell you this, that if you had a conversation with that you back then, with you right now, they would say, you know, it isn't that awesome right now. There are challenges. There's difficulties, there's things, but we look back and it was like, oh, it's wonderful, you know? I mean, sometimes we have a tendency to look back, remember when the girls were little? It was so great. I think I forget early bottle feedings and diapers and all these other things. It's a cloudy lens that we use, to be sure. And we kind of whitewash our past, and that makes our present even bleaker. And that creates this desire for the good old days. Nothing measures up to the good old days. We're still living and looking for those good old days to be repeated. If only I could be back there. If only we could rekindle what we had back then. Listen, sometimes, although I think we should often have fond memories and we should reflect on God's goodness, we should reflect on what he's done in our lives, we should look back and see how we've grown and how we've matured and how God blessed us in every stage of our life. Here's what I can tell you, that sometimes when you are focusing too much on nostalgia, it is keeping you from the best that God has for you here and now. And so celebrate, remember, reminisce, but avoid looking back to some imaginary yesterday that robs you from an authentic life today. God's given you today to make the most of. And he'll give you tomorrow to make the most of. And it may not look like yesterday, but he is still at work. And he still has more for you to do and accomplish. He then reminds us that wisdom is better than prosperity in verses 12. Wisdom is good, with an inheritance and advantage to those who see the sun. For the protection of wisdom is like the protection of money, and the advantages of knowledge is that wisdom preserves the life of him who has it. He's saying, listen, money is good and protection is good, but wisdom is even better. You can count on it. It doesn't just disappear, but it is something that God uses. And then in verses 13 and 14, consider the work of God who can make straight what he has made crooked. In the days of prosperity, be joyful. And in the days of adversity, consider God has made the one as well as the other so that man may not find out anything that will be after him. It's saying that even a wise person is going to go through difficult times. Even a wise person is going to look at certain sections of their life and say, boy, God made that crooked, and that was a hard experience, a hard time in my life. And we can trust that God is up to something good, that God is using this for his glory and for helpful purposes. It's in those moments where I say, God, I don't understand. I don't understand where you're at. I don't understand why you have me in this place. I don't understand why this is bubbling up to the surface. And then I remind myself that he turned the absolutely worst thing into the world, the death of his son, into the greatest news the world has ever heard. And so when I look at the cross, I say, this looks crooked, and I think this way is straight, but I'm going to trust you. You're the ultimate guide. And you're a good God. I will follow. In verses 26 and 20 through 28, he talks about how wisdom isn't seduced. That it's not seduced, and he's talking about here the temptation of a harlot, the temptation of a woman that comes in and draws our ire. And I don't know what temptation you might have, what seduces you away from the Lord, away from purity. But he's saying, be careful. And then in verse 29, see this alone. I found that God made man upright, but they have sought out many schemes. He's saying, put your eyes on Christ. Don't get distracted by the schemes and the challenges and the difficulties of this world. But a better life is a Christ-focused life. A better life is a God-centered life. If you trust Christ, vanity will not be the last word of your life. If you follow Christ, vanity will not be the last word of your existence. It will be victory, right? We sing that old hymn, Victory in Jesus, right? That's what God has for you. So I would much rather take the other V than the one Solomon's trying to convince us not to have. Don't come to the end of your life and have your obituary say, vanity, when God has victory available for his children. What makes the difference? Living life not for things under the sun, but for the one that created the sun, that is above the sun. And so he kind of takes us through a lot of different thoughts, ping-pongs us back and forth in this chapter, and ultimately says this: every day matters. And God is going to use an array of things to keep you sensitive and tender. Trust him. When things are difficult, you're in process. God's at work. When things are enjoyable, praise him. Your life story is going to be a celebration of life when you pass from this earth, because he's given you good things, and you can celebrate them. And when he calls you home, you begin to truly live. This should change all of our perspective in our pursuits under the sun. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that we can learn wisdom. Lord, we realize it's not innate in us. We're not born with it, but you have ample. And you share, and you give, you divinely implant wisdom into us. And so, Lord, we are desperate for it. Lord, we're so thankful for the victory that we have in Christ. And now as we celebrate the resurrected Savior, now as we celebrate the resurrection and the life through Jesus Christ, Lord, as we think back on his broken body, as we long for and anticipate his return, Father, would this be a meaningful moment as your church enjoys this special meal together? In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen.